So last week we talked about how the body can be organized into units, the smallest being atoms. The atoms come together to form chemicals, which come together to make organelles, which make up cells, and so on and so forth, all the way to a human body as we know it. So this week we're going to start small, and we're going to look at some basic chemistry, and we're going to talk about how atoms and chemicals play a big part in our anatomy. So first off, our objectives for this topic. By the end of the week, you should be able to define and differentiate molecules and compounds, discuss the importance of water to physiology, differentiate different ways chemicals can exist in a liquid, differentiate the different types of bonds found in the body, discuss the importance of electrolytes, ions, and the pH scale, and finally discuss the role of fats, carbs, and proteins and what they play in the body. So there's a lot of ground to cover, so let's get started with some definitions. First up, what's an atom? Well, an atom is the smallest unit of matter. It's what makes up all things. Basically, an atom has two parts, a nucleus, which is made up of neutrons and protons, and then some orbiting electrons. They float around it outside. Now, these electrons will be really important when it comes to chemical bonds a little bit later, so don't forget about them. If you've taken a chemistry course before, you've likely seen this table. This is the periodic table, and among other things, it can be a quick way to tell the number of protons an atom has inside its nucleus. Just look at this number right here. It's called the atomic number. Some tables will also have the atomic mass listed underneath, which would represent the number of protons and neutrons in the atom. For this course, I don't need you guys to be able to do anything with these numbers. Just understand the concept of what a proton is, what a neutron is, and what an electron is. Speaking of electrons, these guys like to float around the nucleus in pairs, directly opposite each other. These negatively charged particles space themselves out as much as possible. When there's only a few, they'll stay really close to the nucleus, but as more join, the new ones will orbit further away from the nucleus. We call these different levels of orbit energy levels. Alright, nucleus is made of protons and neutrons, and there's electrons floating around them. Typically, electrons will float around in pairs, or more depending on the energy level, but you shouldn't have one random electron in an orbit by itself. But what do we do if that does happen? Well, the atom doesn't like it. It's considered unstable. So how do we fix it? Well, the easiest way is to form a bond or pair with another atom that needs an extra electron. This is how chemicals are formed. Alright, so elements are atoms that haven't joined with another atom, like this sodium atom right here. Molecules occur when two or more elements match up, oftentimes because they need to even out the number of free electrons that they have. For example, sodium needs one more electron, chloride has one that it needs to ditch, so they form a bond and voila, sodium chloride, or table salt. If a molecule is made up of different elements, for example, table salt, it can also be called a compound. So far we've talked about what an atom is, the parts of it, and why they want to join up with other atoms or form bonds. So there are three ways that atoms can bond to form molecules. We have ionic bonds, covalent bonds, and hydrogen bonds. Sodium chloride is an example of an ionic bond. Sodium needs an electron, chloride has too many, so the electron leaves chloride and goes to sodium. It's a donation of electrons. This is one of the strongest types of chemical bonds, and it's exclusively found in electrolytes, which would also be called inorganic chemistry. Here's a list of the key electrolytes used in the body. The next bond is a covalent bond, and this one's found in organic chemistry. Instead of a straight-up give and take between two elements, in covalent bonds, the two elements decide to share an electron. So the electron will spend some time with one atom, some time with another. It makes them both more stable, or a little bit more stable. An example would be in this sugar molecule made of carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen. The electrons spend their time bouncing between the carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen molecules. These bonds typically aren't as strong as ionic bonds, but they don't dissolve in water like electrolytes, which is why they play a huge role in making up cells of the body. Chemistry that involves carbon mixed with hydrogen and/or oxygen would be considered organic chemistry. The last type of bond I should mention is called hydrogen bonds. You ever take a bunch of magnets and just lay them on a table? The magnets will spin and align themselves in a particular way, every single time. That's because one end of the magnet has a negative charge, and the other one is more positive. Well, hydrogen can act the same way. Because it only has one free electron, when it pairs up with a molecule, that side becomes more negative, while the other side is more positive. When you've got a really long molecule or lots of little molecules near each other, they typically tend to rearrange each other or line themselves up in certain ways, just like the magnets did. This is really important when we look at, like I said, those long compounds or proteins. It allows these proteins to bend and fold and shape, and that shape determines what they do, shapes that are determined by hydrogen bonds.